I want to preface this by saying that we did invite Kathleen Falk to show, and after several attempts, didn't get a response back. So we did what we could, I guess I would say. So, but we're happy to have Kathleen Vinehout here too.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. I was with Kathleen Falk last night. We had a revival. You may remember the western part of the state was kind of the originator of the idea of the revival. Well, they copied it down in Richland Center, and they had a revival variety show last night where they had about 200 or 300 people at an old theater, and Kathleen started it off, and Kathleen ended it. And in the middle, Peter Lavery, who does some music for Wisconsin Public Radio, came and brought us both up on stage and had an ode to the Kathleens. And he said, it's virtually certain that the next governor is going to be named Kathleen. So that was a very good way to kick off the campaign. This is a week of anniversaries, and this particular day is a day that I'll always remember. It's, first of all, my husband's birthday, so I'd better remember it. Second of all, it's the day that I sat down at 4 o'clock in the afternoon and started to read a bill a year ago today, this afternoon. And I finished reading that bill. I closed the bill file at 3:30 in the morning. And all I could think that was that this is the worst thing that could happen to my beloved state. And when I read that bill, what I saw was the crushing of workers' rights, the selling off of state assets without competitively bid contracts, the centralizing of power in the governor's office, the dismantling of the civil service system that was put into place by Bob La Follette in 1905. And then I saw page after page after page of changes in the Medicaid law that gave the power to change all these health programs for 1 in 5 people to an unelected person, the Secretary of Health. And when I finished reading that bill at 3:30 in the morning, I said to myself, I have to find a way to stop this bill. On the 17th of February at 6 o'clock in the morning, I took a call from Senator Miller, and he said, Kathleen, don't go into the Capitol, because if you go into the Capitol, you're going to be followed by a state patrol officer, and your options are going to be very limited. 3 hours later, I was driving south, intent on crossing the border before the gavel fell, opening the Senate session that morning. Now, I was prepared to go to the floor, the Senate floor, and debate the bill, and amend the bill, and delay the bill. But in the end, I knew they had the votes, and we didn't have the power, if I went to the floor, to stop the bill. But we did have the power to stop the process. And in Wisconsin, the Senate doesn't have a filibuster like the federal government does. But we took power that was provided in the Constitution to protect the public from the tyranny of a slight majority when it came to money matters, fiscal matters. And at that point, it was more powerful to not vote than to vote. And our action of not voting gave people time to understand what was in that 144-page bill, which is why it took me so long to read it. Time to communicate, time to organize, and time for people to contact and their own legislators and take back their voice. And I heard that contact from many of you. In a normal year, I have 5,000 people contact me in a year. Within 3 weeks, I had 27,000 people contact me, and 75% of them said to me, stop that bill. So if I didn't go to Illinois, I would not have been doing my job. What we did was we helped people connect the dots. And when they connected the dots, they were outraged by that picture that emerged. We exposed what was happening in Wisconsin to a nation, and the nation responded with a national movement. But even this week, from the calls I've gotten, or some of them were emails, I'm still not sure the people understand what's really happening and what our current leaders are trying to do. When Republicans won control of both houses of the legislature and the governorship, in state after state, an odd thing happened. A steady stream of almost identical bills were introduced, passed, and signed into law. What was happening is the advancing of a right-wing agenda that is conceived in boardrooms, nurtured in retreats, written into legislative proposals by corporate attorneys, and distributed to Republican lawmakers through something called ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Council. It's a nonprofit organization made up of elected officials and funded almost exclusively by corporations, really big corporations. Sometimes Representative Mark Pocan likens it to a dating service between legislators and corporate attorneys. And I looked through this model legislation before they took down their website and I couldn't get into it anymore. And I looked at the bills and I saw bills that tweaked just a little bit to make it consistent with Wisconsin law. They were laws that were moving through the Wisconsin Senate, bills to defund unions, take away consumer protections, give immunity to drug companies, privatize public education, change voting laws to make it harder to vote. If you want to check out any of this, it's on a website called Center for Media and Democracy, and it's called ALEC Exposed. Now, we have a governor who is willing to work with our country's corporate elite and bring this radical agenda to Wisconsin. And in 2010, the governor ran on a platform of jobs, creating jobs. And with record high unemployment, the people hired him to do the job of creating jobs. But once in power, that isn't what he delivered. Instead, he delivered the wish list of this organization called ALEC. And perhaps nowhere is that more clear than what happened in education. I serve on the Senate Committee on Education, and a lot of what I'm going to talk about in education, I've been personally a part of. Watching this and trying to stop it and make it known to people. But we saw, for example, the huge amount of money that's no longer available to schools that was $1.6 billion. We saw the governor pushing legislation to create these private charter schools that could come into River Falls, plop right down next to the school, and yet be controlled by an independent board that is made up of the appointees of the two Fitz brothers and the governor. There are 9-member boards. Each one of them gets 3 appointments. An independent board that the school district would have no control over. We saw an expansion of the voucher program. That's the program where you can take public dollars and use it to buy private school education. It started in Milwaukee. It expanded to Racine. And unless there's currently a law that the Senate passed and the Assembly hasn't, unless that law passes, it could go on to a number of middle-sized cities all across the state. I'll be writing about it this week. I write a weekly column, and that's what my column is going to be about this week. But a funny thing happened when all of this was going on in Wisconsin. The people of Wisconsin woke up. They came to the Capitol to testify, and the current leaders shut them out. With hundreds of people waiting, they wouldn't allow people to testify. Then thousands of people rushed to the Capitol to protest, and the Capitol was limited access in violation of the Constitution. And then to fortify their hold on state government, we saw leaders pass a bill restricting voting rights. And the people were watching in the Senate gallery. And that particular day, all of the people in the Senate gallery were wearing black. And when the oldest serving state legislator, Senator Risser, stood up to speak about the changes in the voting laws, he was gaveled down and told he would not be heard. He could not speak in violation of the Senate rules. And I and my colleagues in that row stood up and said, "You cannot do that. You cannot change the rules." And they did change the rules. And they didn't even allow the Democrats to finish voting. And the people in the gallery that were watching, they stood up and read a speech on voting rights. And they sang together, "We shall overcome." And they said to the Republicans as they left, they said, "Shame, shame." And then they filmed everything that happened and they put it on YouTube so all the people in the state could see what was happening. See, The current leaders tried to silence the people, but the people cannot be silenced. And all across this great state, people are saying, this is not our Wisconsin. Republicans and Democrats are telling me, we want our Wisconsin back, the Wisconsin where everyone came together. And that's why a million people signed the recall petition. Democrats, Republicans, independents, people from all over the state. 30% of the people, they estimate, had never even voted that signed that petition. That's how people have become engaged. I was just at an event in Black River Falls, and I heard a story of Sheila. And I don't know if you know this term, but there's a new term going around describing the person who carried the boxes of the petitions from the U-Haul truck all the way in up the stairs to the Government Accountability Board to deliver those petitions. And they're called the legendary box carriers. Well, Sheila was, Dan was one of the legendary box carriers. There you go, yay Dan. Well, Sheila said when she picked up the box, it was very heavy. And in that box, she said, I felt the pain of losing a job. I felt the heartbreak of a home in foreclosure. I felt the fear of a parent when he or she knew that her child was going to lose health insurance. And then she said, as I walked, I saw the cheers, I heard the cheers, and I saw the people from all over the state, and I felt the hopes, and I felt the dreams, and I felt the dedication, and I felt the respect of so many people. And she said, when I finally made it up the stairs, that box was as light as a feather. Now the world saw the fruits of our labor when those petitions were delivered. And I have to think that Governor Bob La Follette, who was the first person that brought the idea of a recall to the state legislature in 1905, that Governor La Follette would have indeed be proud. And I believe we will clearly demonstrate, as Governor La Follette said many times, the cure for the ills of democracy is more democracy. Now this can only be accomplished by all of us working together. And I believe today Wisconsin is at a crossroads. We can go down the path of Scott Walker, the path of division and deceit, the path of destroying our public structures, the fraying of the social safety net, the cronyism, the corruption, down the path of 6 straight months of job loss. And did you know our neighboring states are doing a better job at creating jobs than our own governor? I did a little bit of research the night of the State of the State speech. If you saw what I wrote, I compared December 2010 jobs to December 2011 jobs. I found that there were 21,000 more jobs, and 18,000 of those were 18,000 Wisconsinites out of 21,000 that were newly working were working outside the state. In fact, our neighboring governors have been 6 times more effective at creating jobs for Wisconsinites than our own governor. So I think we should give our neighboring governors a round of applause. So we can go down that path of 6 straight months of job loss while the rest of our country is recovering. Or we can choose a better way. We can choose wise leaders who put relentless pursuit of the common good above all. Imagine that. Relentless pursuit of the common good. A wise leader knows that we must work in harmony to build prosperity. This past summer, my husband and I had 3 days of vacation, and I went of all places to Madison and Milwaukee. And I had a chance to visit the art museum in Milwaukee. I'd never been to the art museum in Milwaukee, and I went through a replica of a beautiful Chinese garden, a replica with actual artwork from the 18th century Chinese garden, and it was the garden of the longest serving ruler in China, which you know China has a lot of long-serving rulers. And in that garden, the emperor went to take refuge, to meditate, to rest from his labors, to seek wisdom we might heed today. there were all this beautiful landscaping, and then there were these little buildings. And three of those buildings caught my eye. And it gave me some insight into the emperor's mind and maybe into a little bit into the secret of his success. There was the studio of self-restraint. There was the supreme chamber of creating harmony. And then there was the pavilion of prosperity. So I thought, self-restraint, harmony, and prosperity. Three words we don't hear very much in Wisconsin these days. Prosperity eludes us because we haven't figured out that prosperity is built on self-restraint and harmony. If the emperor does everything he wants, there will be no harmony. So, you know, there's no harmony in a state where the CEO of the state laughs in that fake Koch brothers telephone call. He laughed over dropping the bomb on his own people, which is how he described Act 10. That there's no harmony there. How does a wise emperor create harmony? Well, you could probably tell me. By mutual respect, by valuing the people of the kingdom, and by creating a vision of prosperity that provides for the common good and for all, that vision of prosperity. Now, when I'm talking to people around Wisconsin, I sense that that yearning for harmony is much greater among independents, Republicans, and Democrats than among our current leaders. People know that hard times are upon us, that it's going to be difficult for us to move forward. But as a fellow in Northfield told me, he said, Kathleen, I know it's going to hurt. I just want that hurt to be fair. We need a fresh start in Wisconsin politics and government. We need to heal those divisions among us. We need to respect each other while we debate our differences. And we need to stop pitting government and the public sector against the private sector. We need to stop pitting management and business against labor. We're all suffering, and we are all only going to move forward together. And we need everybody's best efforts to create the kind of communities that we want to live in and work in and raise a family. Wisconsin needs a fresh start, and we need new leadership. And we need a leader who's going to lift up the voices of the people and do the will of the people. We need a leader who's going to govern with self-restraint. We need a leader who's going to be truthful about her intentions. And we need a leader who's going to respect Wisconsin's traditions of good government, of openness, of full participation, of following the rules. And I pledge to be that kind of leader.
Yeah. Amen.
Often I'm asked about the environment in which I work and the world of politics, and they say, can't you change the politicians you work with, Kathleen? And I say to them, I can change only one politician, and that is me. And I live my life by the saying of Gandhi, be the change you want to see. And I believe Wisconsin needs a fresh start in government and politics, and we can be that change. So I challenge you. If you don't like money in politics, work for the candidate with less money. If you don't like scripted sound bites, work for the candidate that respects your intelligence. And if you don't like negative campaigning, work for the candidate that talks about solutions and doesn't talk trash.
Yeah.
If you don't like politics as usual, work for the unusual candidate.
Yeah.
Now, right now, we're trying to beat our opponents in a game where they are rewriting the rules, and you know the story. They changed the voting laws, they changed the lines of the legislative districts, they changed the campaign finance laws to bring in unlimited money in campaigns, but they still haven't changed the most important voting law there is, which is one person, one vote. And we know that when people turn out to vote in unprecedented numbers, democracy wins. And I am asking you, just like the Wisconsin 14, we have to all muster that courage and determination to take a bold step out of our comfort zone and help open the eyes to our brothers and sisters of what's really happening. We have an important task ahead of us. We have to inform, educate, and motivate our neighbors. And ladies and gentlemen, Wisconsin is ground zero. The fight is for all the marbles, and our opponents are playing for keeps. But we will show the world we are awake. We are engaged. We are fighting for democracy, for our communities, and for the future of our state. Because when you be the change you want to see, our communities change. Our state changes, and we change. And all it takes is one person at a time saying, I will be the change I want to see, starting right here, right now, today, in River Falls. Thank you very much.
Yeah.